My name is Bill Dudley, and I had the privilege of serving as the chairman of the Stated Clerk Search Committee 2 years ago, along with a host of representatives from presbyteries all across our denomination. And last year in the virtual meeting, we had the privilege of recommending to you the selection of that committee of Dean Weaver as our new stated clerk. And I think I would be remiss. That was a little bit anticlimactic. I mean, I have to say to you that I tried to put a little color into it, but it didn't work, and it was stiff, and it was a little bit challenging. I think the assembly really needs to affirm again the recommendation which our committee brought to you, and that is the endorsement, the call of Dean Weaver, and also that of his wife Beth, who is here with him tonight. But would you join me in thanking God for this call upon Dean's life in this ministry? That was just a little pause from last year, and I also have considered it. Let me ask also. There are plenty of our search committee. If you were on that search committee, would you just stand, just so that you can recognize you and thank you for the service of these men and women. That was I thought that going into a session meeting at Signal Mountain Presbyterian Church unprepared was the greatest disaster of my life, but the greatest disaster was trying to sort of keep this committee in tow. They're the most strong-willed group of individuals that I have ever met, and they did not regard the chairman with high respect. Tonight really began in a different place some years ago. It was in Rome, New York, where Jeff was born. The first of four children, born into a military family, an Air Force family. And family members said they could easily recognize the evidence that he was the oldest child and had that syndrome, being dutiful and responsible and dedicated, and I would say strong-willed is what we also have recognized in the 15 years that we have had him as our leader. Their family grew to six, and over 14 years, Jeff Jeremiah was in 10 different school districts. In 14 years, which lets you know what the challenges of that family were like moving from destination to destination and creating community everywhere they went. He learned at a very young age to adjust to change and to changing communities, to move in early, to set up your identity, to create your space, and to become a part of all that was around him. That adaptation and that skill and gift has served him well in congregations and in communities since that time. But at this very same time, there was another military family, but they were not Air Force. They were United States Army. And they had a very beautiful daughter who was accenting their family. Like Jeff's family, Cindy's family was also one that was on the move. Assignments in Okinawa, in South America, Europe, and in other locations. The interesting thing is that their parents had become good friends in all of the travels that they had, and so their families knew one another and had exchanges of fellowship and shared times with one another. Jeff and Cindy attended the same high school. You're going to get the point in this in a minute that this was a family arranged marriage. It was there were too many benefits, and it was while they were in high school that they began dating. Jeff went off to the College of William and Mary. Cindy went to George Mason. They continued their friendship until all of a sudden, in a certain period of time, this close friendship took a deep, deep turn. And that was a turn upward in affirmation and affection for one another. And they were married in 1978 on August the 12th at Farlington. Did I get that right? Farlington Presbyterian Church in Alexandria, Virginia. After college and after their marriage, while active in a PCUS congregation, Louisville Church in McLean, Virginia, Jeff began discerning the Lord's call upon his life. And it was out of that discernment of call that he entered Gordon Conwell Seminary and was there from 1977 to 1980, which easily fed Jeff into the position when he graduated of becoming the associate pastor at Fourth Church in Bethesda, where he was richly mentored, as he shared last night, by the renowned Dick Halverson. All of us as pastors who grew up in that period of time would have envied Jeff or any other member of that staff to have had the privilege of serving alongside and under the leadership of this great leader in the Presbyterian Church. He was at Fourth Presbyterian Church for 14 years, and during this time created a wonderful, wonderful reputation for himself, sharpening his talents and skills and his gifts in leadership and in creativity and in administration, forming an impetus for ministries that would be serving other members of that staff. As I'm told, he was an encourager and an advancer of those other members of staff serving well in that congregation. 1992, he obtained his PhD in history from George Mason University, and then shortly thereafter took a call to First Church EPC at Renton, Washington. And that's where the trouble really began for Jeff, because it was in this period of time in 2006 that Jeff was asked to serve on the Stated Clerk Search Committee. Now, don't go there now. I mean, he didn't buy the position, so let me get through. For those of us who've served on it, we know what a challenging time that a Stated Clerk Search Committee can look like, and that's the reason I had my comrades to stand up here and be recognized, because that is a very, very delicate challenge. And Jeff was serving on that committee in 2006, along with the chairman of that committee, John Adamson, and I'm going to ask him to pick up the story about that call and about that activity of that search committee. John?
Thank you, Bill. It's a real honor to be part of this celebration tonight. As Bill said, at the 25th General Assembly in 2005, a search committee was appointed to seek the next Stated Clerk to replace Mike Lotto. There were 9 members of the committee, and I was appointed chairman. 3 of those people are here tonight, myself, Jeff, and Dexter Kuhlman. The other 6 are not able to be with us. 1 is deceased. But all 8 presbyteries were represented on the search committee. And as Bill said, the representative from the Presbytery of the West was none other than Jeff Jeremiah. But I'll talk more about that in a minute. We had a wonderful committee. And we worked well together. And of course, our work was immersed with a lot of prayer. We first advertised within the denomination and to outside groups. We had a few inquiries, but almost no applications. After a couple of months, we began to look at our churches in the denomination to identify those that we thought might be interested. We found several. We had contacted them. A few were interested. But in the end, we decided that none of them were the right fit either. By this time, it was late winter or early spring of 2006, and we realized that we were mandated to make a recommendation at the June 2006 General Assembly in Rome, Georgia. We decided that all we could do would be to look for someone to serve as an interim for 1 or 2 years while we continued to search, since we had not been able to come up with any candidates. We identified someone who was not in the EPC, was well qualified, and had the executive skills needed. We approached him, and he was open to talk to us. So for several weeks, we communicated with him, and in May had a face-to-face meeting, and we shared our vision for the EPC and its future. Nothing like what has happened, thank goodness, but that was our thoughts at the time. And he shared with us how he thought he might could lead us during this interim period. At the end of the meeting, he agreed to consider serving as the interim while we continued to search. And that was the best plan we had at the time. 1 week before the General Assembly in 2006, that candidate advised me that he could not take the position. So we had no alternative except to report to the General Assembly that we did not have a recommendation, but we would keep searching, which we did. Let me back up. During the meeting with the interim candidate, I was sitting next to Jeff, and we were talking about the future and what the EPC could be again. And so we said, Jeff wrote a note to me and slipped it under my notebook. And I looked at it and he said, you know, if this man takes a position, I'd like to consider following him, perhaps as stated clerk. So I just folded the note up and put it in my pocket. So after the June General Assembly, I called Jeff and asked him if he would be interested in serving as a candidate for the General Assembly. He said he would think about it, he would pray about it, but he did agree to meet with the committee. So I said, Jeff, I think the first thing you need to do is resign from the committee because I don't think we need to be choosing one of our own as a recommendation. And he did resign. So for the next, 6 or 8 weeks, we communicated with Jeff as a candidate and not as one of our own. And so he met with us, and we decided that without a doubt he was our choice and God's choice for the position. So we voted unanimously to recommend him. Get this, in September of 2006, the first and only call meeting of the General Assembly was convened by conference call. Zoom hadn't even been thought of by 2006. So we had our conference call, General Assembly call meeting, and Jeff was unanimously elected to be the third stated clerk of our denomination. Let me just say that in the ensuing 15 years after that election, I think that Jeff has confirmed that he was God's choice for this position. I don't know of anybody that could have accomplished all that he accomplished in that 15 years. Who would have dreamed that we would have grown from 8 presbyteries to 14, soon to be 16, or grown from 180 churches to over 600? Also, the General Assembly office was relocated to Orlando. And there are countless other accomplishments, too many to mention. But let me just conclude my remarks by saying, well done, Jeff, good and faithful servant, and thank you.
And so Jeff had these images of sitting on his front porch rocking and just enjoying the pastime of being a stated clerk, working every other day and having weekends off, and just had all of those images of what it would be like to be sort of semi-retired. No one, and including Jeff and Cindy, could have possibly known what was a mounting surge of church activity that was to begin. For less than 6 months after Jeff assumed this role, the PCUSA was boiling over with theological and spiritual differences, and church after church after church began inquiring about the EPC. We were like immigrants, crowded on a ship, fleeing disaster, and praying that somebody would save us, would welcome us to the shores of their church. And humbly were we received into the EPC. And this denomination not only welcomed us, but affirmed us and asked us to bring what we had to share in the church. Jeff was the upfront man for almost every congregation, personally touching each congregation, each pastor in some form or another. And how that was possible, none of us could possibly know that. But those of us who were immigrants, by his own pastoral leadership, and you, the legacy ones of the EPC, you're the ones who made us not immigrants any longer, but citizens. Citizens not only shared in the kingdom of God, but citizens in this beloved denomination that we cherish. And there's not anybody any more equipped to speak to that than our new stated clerk, Dean Weaver.
Let the record show that when Bill sent his kind words earlier in this evening about Beth and I, the first person in the standing ovation was Jeff Jeremiah. Let me just point that out. When he sat down, I said, Jeff, why were you the first one standing? He said, because I am out of here on Friday. And by the way, just so that you can give him a little bit of love, Jeff's birthday is on Monday. That's right, 59 years old. It's just fantastic. Well, thank you, Bill. And I served with Bill Myers as the co-chair of the Joint Commission that helped 182 churches from the New Wineskins Association, along with my dear friend Garrett Dawson. We helped those churches navigate their way into the EPC during that period of time. And so I had a front row seat to witness that transition that Bill spoke about. And I will tell you, there are three words that I want to use to describe Jeff for those of us who made that holy migration. One of the terms is one that is understood, one that is perhaps unexpected, and one that is uncontested. The understood word is leader. He was understood by all. We were leaderless. We needed a home. We needed a place to go to. And Jeff demonstrated uncompromising leadership throughout that process. I'm just curious to see a sign of hands. For those of you who migrated out of the PCUSA into the EPC, how many of you just by chance, whether at your church or at a church near you, had the chance to see Jeff Jeremiah come and advocate for your congregation? Put those hands up. Put those hands up. I see you. I see you. I see you. It's unbelievable the miles he racked up. It's unbelievable the people who called and said at the last minute, our church is going to vote this weekend. Who can you send? And like Isaiah, here I am, send me. He just got on a plane and went. At incredible price and cost. A leader pays the price, and Jeff and Cindy have paid that price again and again and again. But much like a group of people that needed to be led out of a place of deep, dark oppression, we found our Moses, and he led us, and it is absolutely and completely, without question, understood that Jeff was, in that time of transition, above all else, a leader. The unexpected term, Jeff was a shock absorber. I want you to think about that for a second. Where would your car be without it? I have driven on for thousands of miles on bumpy, dusty Sierra Leonean roads, and I would tell you without those shock absorbers, I don't know where the body would be. Here's how the shock absorber works. As 182 churches of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church get ready over a five-year period of time to take in about 180 churches from the New Wineskins Association of Churches, here's what happens. You have 182 churches on one side who say, oh no! What in the world? Fearful of what doubling their denomination could look like. Legacy churches and people would call Jeff, and Jeff would have to calm fears and reassure them and make phone calls and go do visits and absorb the shock that was coming from the existing organization, because it was a shock. It was a welcome one, but it was a lot to absorb. And for those of us who came in from the PCUSA, I want you to understand the price that this man paid in absorbing the shock so that we could come in and find smooth roads. Now, on the other side of the occasion, you have all those 180-some-odd churches that come with all of their baggage with them. And here's the thing. I would tell pastors all the time, you had better have a vision of a land flowing with milk and honey, because if your only motive of leaving your denomination is to get out of Egypt, at some point in time, if your only vision is getting out, we're going to have, and churches brought their baggage with them, all their fears, all of their apprehensions. And here's the biggest thing he absorbed. It seems intangible, but it's huge. All of us who came out of the PCUSA came out of a culture of distrust into an organization of profound trust. And the fact that we sit here tonight and all nod our heads and say, yep, the ethos and culture of the EPC is one of trust, that's because we had a shock absorber who took all of that from both sides to make sure that that continued to be true. And it's true to this day. And the body, the chassis, has held together, though these 15 years later, and is purring along just great because of the shock absorber who absorbed all of that. So if it's understood that Jeff is the leader and unexpected, perhaps maybe you didn't realize how much he absorbed in that transition time period. What is uncontested, and all of us have experienced it firsthand, is that Jeff is above all, especially to those of us who made that migration in. He was our pastor. I was privileged to sit on the Committee on Administration at the time that would later become the National Leadership Team, and we tried, unsuccessfully, mind you, to change the title of Stated Clerk. Oh, how I wish we had succeeded. Because everywhere you go, if you tell anybody outside of a Presbyterian denomination in the United States, well, what do you do for a living? I'm the Stated Clerk. They just look at you and have no concept of what that means. What we tried to do, and we were unsuccessful because the Permanent Judicial Commission ruled that this was inconsistent with our Constitution, we wanted to change Jeff's title to lead pastor of the denomination. Because we all universally understood that that's exactly what he was doing. Yes, he has been our stated clerk, but he has been our pastor. And it wasn't just about absorbing the shock as people came out of one system into another system. It was about doing it with a pastor's heart in helping people to get there and to make sure that that could happen. Even to the point where I think it was just about maybe 3 months ago when we had an unbelievable tragedy in our denomination. A second career pastor in his first church, there not more than 2 months, is tragically killed in a car accident. And without thinking about it, and I'm sure Cindy didn't even blink an eye, he gets in the plane and flies down to that church to be with those people, to be with the widow and her children. And he comes back and he sits down with Jerry and I and says, look, this church can't absorb it. The presbytery can't absorb it. Their home church sending church can't absorb it. We've got money in the medical benevolence fund. We're going to take care of this family. We're going to financially take care of this family. And he pastored them. I don't even think he knew them, but they were an EPC pastor's family, and he was their lead pastor. This was just 2 months ago. He has done this again and again and again and again. And I'll tell you what, a lot of us who are coming out of the PCUSA, especially those of us who are pastors and coming into the EPC, you know what us pastors needed? We needed a pastor. And it is uncontested that Jeff has been the lead pastor of all of our churches and our pastors. Maybe unexpected to you that he was a bit of a shock absorber, but I will tell you, Jeff, we all know, has been a great leader in helping God bring all of those churches, mine included, into the EPC. And for that, for my dear brother, I am forever grateful. And for all of us who made that migration and have found that home that Bill talked about, for all of us who made that migration, would you please agree and say with me, amen.
Amen.
You'll gather, conclude as we go through this program that we have not known what the other person's going to say. And so you're going to have to listen to me again, repeat what Dean has just said. But let me say that one of those shock absorbers was the influx of PCUSA congregations. Jeff was the person who didn't see groups of people. He saw individuals. And that's evident here in the life of our church tonight. You know, we celebrate the fact that he has brought to leadership and to activity African-American members of the EPC, and we celebrate that we have had a wonderful, wonderful moderator this past year. That's Jeff. Internationals that have become well-known by name to us, not living in distant lands, but those that are dear and special and precious to us. He saw the individuals, and he saw their gifts and called them into places where they could make a difference in the kingdom of God with and among us in the EPC. Well, none was as ticklish and as requiring of the shock absorber than that of what to do with women teaching elders. And there was high anxiety as those who are complementarians were concerned about the influx of egalitarians and how are we going to live in harmony with each other with these differences. And again, all I know is that the Holy Spirit anointed this man, and he went from one place to another place, and he spoke to one side and to another side and said, we can do this. With one another, we can do this. And I'm here to tell you that it wouldn't have happened with another leader. Nancy Duff.
My first memory of Jeff Jeremiah was at a town hall meeting at CPC Danville. Jeff was there, of course, to represent the EPC. I was there as a living, breathing example of a woman pastor who had successfully navigated that move. I talked about my experience in those two denominations. I talked about how it felt like the difference between bureaucracy and family. I talked about how in the PCUSA, I felt more a minority as an evangelical than I did in the EPC as a woman pastor. I felt in the PCUSA like a token. In the EPC, I was Nancy, valued for who I was. In the EPC, I said, everybody knows my name. And then it was Jeff's turn. And he started his remarks by saying, I believe, and he did one of his wonderful Jeff pauses. I believe this is the first time I have ever heard our denomination compared to a bar. For those of you too young to get that reference, he was referring to the TV show Cheers, which is about a bar where everybody knows your name. For the last decade, every time Jeff and I have been together in a new group of people, Jeff finds somebody new to tell that story to. I am the woman who compared our denomination to a bar. And I stand by that. As Jeff has said so frequently, we are a relational bunch. One of the next times I saw Jeff was at another town hall meeting up in Chapel Hill, Gig Harbor. And as we were getting ready to do the same presentations, I was standing in the back with Jeff, and someone came up. I think it was a PCUSA pastor, as I recall, and he told Jeff about a rumor going around a number of the PCUSA churches in that area that the EPC did not support women in ministry. I was horrified. I wanted to do something. And Jeff turned to me, and he said, "Nancy, this is spiritual warfare." It just took those five words to turn my indignation to prayer. Jeff discerned the spiritual issue. Jeff has done that so ably, so often for us over the years. After that meeting, Jeff and Cindy and Scott and Mary Griffin invited me to go with them to dinner. They took me to a bar. Tide's Tavern. They welcomed me into their friendship circle that night. Later, at my first GA, Cindy, you greeted me at the registration table. You knew my name. Later, Jeff, you called me the night before I had surgery, and you prayed for me. You pastored me. Jeff and Cindy, you have modeled to all of us what it means to live together as brother and sister in Christ. You have loved us so much that you have been delighted to share not only the gospel of God, but your lives as well, as Paul says. And we thank you for that. In my presbytery, the water was fine for women teaching elders. That was the Presbytery of the West, and it became the Presbytery of the Pacific, and then the Presbytery of the Pacific Southwest. And when in the Presbytery of the Pacific years, I was elected moderator, and Jeff was there to cheer me on. The waters were fine in my presbytery, but for some teaching elders who were women in some presbyteries, the waters were not fine. They were choppy, rough, and as Dean described, Jeff dove into those waters. He used his relational capital. He used the trust he had built to help us learn how to navigate living together in this denomination. Navigate learning what it means to agree on the essentials, to honor one another as we differ on non-essentials, and to show grace and charity in all things to one another. Jeff gave us that gift over and over and over again. He showed up in the difficult moments and helped us be our best selves. And Cindy made all of that possible by carrying the load at home. We still have a long way to go as a denomination, but the Jeremiahs have helped us stay true to the founding ethos of this denomination, to stay true to God's call to us as a denomination. It would have been easy for us to veer from that, to tend towards bureaucracy or to start moving towards denominational infighting and deciding who's in and who's out. It still would be easy for us to veer from our founding DNA. But God has called us, the EPC, to live in that middle space, to choose together to agree on the essentials, to honor one another as we express liberty in our non-essentials, and to act in grace, in charity towards one another. And in doing that, we present to the world, this world that is becoming more and more polarized, we present to the world what it looks like when brothers and sisters practice the one another's of the New Testament together, when brothers and sisters are sold out together for the kingdom of God. Jeff and Cindy have kept us anchored to our DNA, to our ethos. That is their legacy to us. And I believe that the greatest tribute that we can give them in the ongoing years is to cling fast to that ethos, to continue to be a relational bunch, to continue to submit ourselves one to another, to subject ourselves to our fellow presbyters, as so many of us have vowed to do in our ordination vows, to continue practicing the one another's, to continue to trust one another, to pick up the phone instead of grumbling or filing an overture or moving down an ecclesiastical complaint. Jeff and Cindy, we thank you. And as God leads you into this next phase, we thank him for our partnership in the gospel with you together. We always will be your church. We always will be your family. We always will know your names. Cheers.
Well, this is one of those stories that I will contrast with Dean, because I did not on the administrative committee. I did not support lead pastor. I did not think that was appropriate. I thought that we needed to have a title that was more biblical. And this is a political statement, because I've never put it down. All these years, I have continued to say that the biblical term that needs to be embraced is that of bishop. And I didn't even get a second for that. Somebody was saying Episcopal, Anglican, and Catholic. I understand that, but they've got bishop wrong from the biblical. Jeff is the bishop. I'm going to get that before I depart this earth. Well, I want you to know that that I couldn't agree more with Dean's colorful description of Jeff. You know, I'd go to a funeral of a teaching elder, and there would be Jeff. And I would know that a church was in crisis, and I would find out Jeff was there. But none of that really made any difference until it hits home. For 40 years, I served in another denomination. And in those 40 years, I never had a pastor. And I never, ever had a stated clerk ever pray with me. And I'd gone through the death of a child, had gone through a tragic accident of my own. I'd only been in the EPC only a short time when I developed a medical issue. I'd been in intensive care for over a week, and it was a cold, wet day in Chattanooga, Tennessee, and I had just been rolled from that morning from intensive care to my room, and I really felt horrible. And there came a knock at my door, and the door opened, and there was Jeff Jeremiah. And that day, I was prayed for by a pastor who came to visit me and to care for me. And he sat there an entire day while the snowstorm just kept blowing across Chattanooga. He was headed home and get stranded in Atlanta in the midst of the snow. And did that for a pastor that needed care. That doesn't happen, not even in other conservative evangelical denominations. It's rare. What we saw as a church, though, was the passion of this man to care for pastorally and to love a forgotten missionary in a distant country, and not just one of that family, but the family as a whole. He led us. We learned to sing together a hymn that Andrew had written. And he led us to know Andrew and Norine as if they lived next door to us. He taught us how to pray. And we cheered him on when he went into political circles that were strange and different for him. The pastor just kept on being the pastor, even after he was told he could no longer keep that pace. And no one, apart from their family, suffered for the gospel in Andrew and Noreen's life and ministry than Jeff.
The first time I talked with Jeff, I'd known his name, but I'd been in prison almost 2 years. And how remarkable what Jeff did for someone he'd never met and never even talked to. The first time I heard about Jeff, Norine, I was in solitary at the time. I was in a detention center. I was going crazy in solitary confinement. They let me see Norine, and she told me there's a clerk in an EPC church who's written to me, and he wants to help you. And I thought, well, so a guy who takes the minutes when they have the church session is, yeah. I said, God bless him, but what is he going to do for me? Yeah. So I'd like to revisit the title of Stated Clerk. I'll also say, we had a hard time translating this when Jeff wrote a letter to the president of Turkey. What is a stated clerk? So, and then I found out that this wasn't clerk as I understood it. It was a super clerk. One of the most discouraging things is to hear someone say, we're monitoring the situation. And there were so many people who could have done something. And Norine would get the answer, we're monitoring the situation. And that really closely. Means we're monitoring it closely. And that what I understood immediately is we're not doing anything. We're observing from afar. We're not really going to take any action. And I was so desperate at that time. Will somebody please fight for me? Will somebody please do something rather than just monitor the situation? And Jeff did not monitor the situation. He took action. He did so much. And I'm so grateful for this. When I first started, when I found out what he was actually doing from Norine, because we had no direct communication, this was an encouragement as I started to think, here's someone, this was after a couple months, here's someone who's finally starting to do something for us and is investing his heart in this. And God was setting us up in a way, because all of those years that Jeff had spent in Washington, D.C. area at 4th Presbyterian, he had many contacts. And I think early on, he was able to bring us to the attention of Vice President Pence before he took office. And then with Mike Pompeo, the Secretary of State, Jeff was also onto this and bringing us to people's attention. We were known to very few people in the EPC. And Jeff changed that for someone he didn't know. And he took up our cause. And I think there's something here that I don't know if Jeff really knew what he was doing in this, but he was really being responsive to the Holy Spirit, because there were many people so many people prayed for me in the EPC. And this was not just about setting me free. God did not need so many people to pray so fervently for so long a period of time. God was doing something much bigger than this. And Jeff was the one that God was really using to raise this prayer up in the EPC. And it was such an encouragement to me. And I do believe in the years ahead, as God reveals what he was doing, you'll see that this prayer is such a big part of what God is going to use to prepare that area for harvest, not only Turkey, but the area around it. We will see a harvest. And underlying that will be this prayer that Jeff had such an important role in raising. So I'm so grateful for that wave of prayer. When we returned to the States, to add insult to injury, since I was found guilty as being a terrorist, they imposed fees on me for court costs. I thought, how are we going to pay for this? And we told Jeff within a few days that was taken care of. We didn't have the finances when we came back to the States to set up in any way. And when Jeff found out about this, within a very short time, he made this known to the denomination. There was a transition fund. And that was so generous and done so quickly. We were so grateful for this. And this really came from Jeff's heart. So I have known Jeff for a lot less time than most of you in this room. But I don't think there's anybody who owes more to Jeff than I do.
Yeah, I think everything that we've been hearing tonight just confirms what we experienced ourselves. Him leaving the 99 to go rescue the one who was in trouble, in a sense. There are a couple words that just really are in my mind when I think of Jeff. I think of his heart, and that he was tireless. He did not stop. So, as Andrew said, Jeff appeared on the scene during Andrew's second month of imprisonment. Others were appearing on the scene too, many others actually. But within a little while, Jeff's name kept coming up and he started to stand out. And he called to check in regularly. And just by his questions and what he was saying, I could almost hear him taking notes on the other side. So I could tell he's following this carefully. The situation, any information I had, how Andrew was doing. As time went on, I started to wonder, does this man have a job? because it felt like he's going to go circle back around D.C. for us. He's calling. He's writing. You know, he's traveling. I mean, it was so much for us. I thought, how can he be maintaining anything else on the side? He was praying. He was thinking. He was raising prayer across the denomination. And as Andrew said, he didn't need to do this. We'd come into the EPC in 2010. Actually, I had remained in Turkey. Andrew came over, transferred his ordination, and then we were just, he was a minister out of bounds, and people didn't know us. And so here, suddenly, the stated clerk is taking our case very personally. It wasn't just a job for him. And I knew and I felt, I could just feel that he truly cared. He carried Andrew in his heart. It was almost, I just felt him suffering alongside Andrew. I that just came through so clearly. And tonight, as I'm hearing all the stories of the pastoral heart, we experienced it firsthand over that two-year period. Just a little small thing. I loved how he would sign off his emails and remember he is risen. And that always spoke to me. We are Resurrection Church. That's also part of a name God has given me. So it's just like that, just God putting that in there time and again, resurrection. It's all about hope against all hope. I appreciated that. So, yeah, Jeff, we are eternally grateful to you. We thank you from our hearts. And it's a joy to be able to honor you here and to hear you honored by others.
The hymn verse is, we share our mutual woes, our mutual burdens bear, and often for each other flows the sympathizing tear. Perhaps the greatest gift beyond any of those that have been mentioned that Jeff and Cindy have given to us is the mentoring illustration of what is essential, what is important. It's the two of them, for nothing surpasses God's call upon us as leaders beyond that which is our call of covenant family and covenant marriage. Jeff and Cindy, you have fulfilled your vows before us, the church, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish. And what a season it's been to be taught by you without words, but by behavior. That brings me to the one who probably can speak more personally than even I, as being the best travel companion you could have had, your wonderful caregivers and your closest friends, in Mary and Scott. And would you join me here? Scott's going to come and stand with Mary as she speaks and shares. I just love telling you what to do. I love directing you for it.
When Bill Dudley called and asked me to speak to all of you tonight, of course, I was delighted. And he said,
"You're closer."
That's Scott's job tonight. Bill said, "I want Scott up there too, but I don't want him to say anything." We have been friends with Jeff and Cindy since, it was mentioned, 1994, when Jeff became the senior pastor at First EPC in Renton, Washington, and it's now New Hope Church. We raised our kids together. We had Thanksgivings, Christmases, graduations, weddings, so many fun memories with one another. However, I did mention to Jeff, it was the first time in my life that I had a senior pastor who was younger than me. He's 24 days younger than me, not that I'm counting, but. And every year he sends such lovely cards reminding me that I am older and wiser and I can lead the way into the new year. Thank you, Jeff. So on this very special evening where we have been delighted to tell Jeff how much we appreciate his time in ministry, it is my special honor to get to thank Cindy for her important part in this ministry. Cindy, from the very beginning, you have been Jeff's greatest encourager and greatest supporter. And we know that Jeff's acceptance of this position brought changes for your whole family. And I watched you handle all of those changes with both grace and good humor. Now, part of the reason you're able to do that so well is you're a lot of fun to be with. And you do genuinely bring the joy of the Lord wherever you go. You are a wonderful conversationalist and a great listener. You are fully present when you're talking to someone and genuinely interested in other people, getting to know them and their story. And I know there are many of us here tonight and watching remotely who could recount a time when they first met Cindy, how she quickly put them at ease and made them feel as if they'd known one another much longer than just a few minutes. You have a gift for encouraging others. You are quick to give words of affirmation and you ask great questions. I have received many of these encouraging words from you over the years, and there are many people in the EPC family that have received those wonderful encouraging words from you as well. It's been mentioned that you've been here at the registration table many times during general assemblies, and I know people looked forward to being greeted by you because you made it very clear that you were happy to see us and glad we had come, and that was a real gift. You are a prayer warrior, my friend. Thank you for praying for Jeff, for praying for everyone in leadership in the EPC, for praying for us individually and our families. You have sent letters and notes, made phone calls, sent emails, and visited countless numbers of us. And we thank you. Thank you for your willingness to share Jeff with us, but also, Cindy, for your willingness to share yourself with us. You are so gifted in caring for other people that we did not want this night to end without taking the opportunity to say that God has used you in a powerful way to bless all of us. We are grateful. We love you. And we thank you very, very much.
Well, it's time to close. The testimonies could go on and on and on because there's one in with every table. But I didn't prepare a closing. And I intentionally didn't prepare a closing because not a closing is not needed tonight. We're not closing anything. We just are continuing to be the body of Christ, the family of God, and we'll continue being what our pastor has shown and taught us and led us to do. And we'll do it even in grander form than he could ever imagine or think about us. We will be those that are called to move forward into a new era of time and ministry with the words of that hymn that would say, "Onward then, you people, join the happy throng, blend with ours your voices in the triumph song. We are not divided, all one body we, one in hope and doctrine, and one in charity." But like the community of Israel, we do need to commemorate, and we do need to gather the stones and put them together and say, God has done something great here in 15 years, and we need to celebrate that. Case Thorp, would you come and make a presentation for us?
The Presbytery of Florida and the Caribbean, the greatest one, now the home of the Office of the General Assembly, we wanted to express an appreciation for the vision, the service, and the success of Jeff Jeremiah as Stated Clerk. So we sought a project that would reflect Jeff's love of the church, along with something that would advance the mission of the church. Gen X and millennial pastors across the EPC know him to be a great mentor, as do I, one who cares and one who will go to bat for them. Jeff Jeremiah cares about the next generation of church leadership. Jeff, as you've heard, having earned a PhD himself, is a champion of education, and he knows the value of having well-educated and well-trained leaders for the future of the church. So we wondered, down in Florida, if there was a way that we might assist the mission of Reformed Theological Seminary in Orlando, right in our own backyard, that they might have a way that could help us find that perfect intersection between Jeff's interests and something that advances the kingdom. So working with Lee Swanson, Vice President of Community Relations, we identified RTS Orlando's desire to provide more spaces of fellowship, both for students and visitors on campus. RTS has a commitment to two main things: sound doctrine and sincere love. Academic buildings help with the teaching of doctrine, but spaces for fellowship, laughter, storytelling, deepening vulnerability with one another, are the places where love really does grow and mature. So our presbytery put a challenge out to other presbyteries to help us bring about such a space so that future pastors could grow in sincere love. I'm pleased to share, Jeff, that we, along with the presbyteries of the East, Gulf South, Midwest, Mid-Atlantic, and West, joined arms to honor you with the Jeremiah Patio at RTS Orlando. Now, this space will be right there in the center of campus as you walk into the campus. It will provide two fire pits, which you know you got to have in Florida. Numerous Adirondack chairs for students and guests to enjoy the beautiful flora and fauna while growing in love. And hey, we raise a little bit more money, we can get you a crypt. I mean, Bill and Vonette Bright are just down the road. If you... Once completed, if you come and visit, you will find a bronze plaque that reads, "The Jeremiah Patio." Oh yeah, there's the two Fire pits. Yeah. The plaque will say the Jeremiah Patio, given to the glory of God in honor of the Reverend Dr. Jeffrey J. Jeremiah. Wrong guy. Oops. Stated Clerk of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, 2006 to 2021, the Presbytery of Florida and the Caribbean, the greatest, and the Presbyteries of the East, Midwest, Mid-Atlantic, Gulf South, and West. I'm just kidding, Stated Clerks of those presbyteries. Don't come talk to me afterwards. And then a scripture verse. But the Lord said to me, quote, do not say, I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to, everyone I send you to, and say whatever I command you. Jeremiah, that's good, wasn't it? Jeremiah, I thought of that one. 1:7. Now, Ron Horgan and I, just before we're talking too, you know how in your videos you say, he is risen? Like, if we could have the finger one day and put a relic in the fire pit, it'd go along great with the crypt for the future pilgrimages. Thank you, Jeff Jeremiah.
Well, our last gesture is to return you tonight to your family. Jeff to Cindy and Cindy to Jeff, to your sons and their families, Dan and Jeff and Stacy and Michael and Emily and your grands, and to offer to you and to them our affirmation and thanksgiving, and to do it in a manner, too, that we want to bless the household of Jeremiah. Now, John was chairman of that committee, and he hired you, so I thought it would be appropriate for him to, well, not fire you, but for him, if he hired you, he could be the one to dismiss you. So, John, if you will come up and complete us tonight.
Thank you. Would the two of you come up, Jeff, you and Cindy? You've heard a lot of people, or several people, express their gratitude, but this gratitude goes much further than that, because individuals, churches, and presbyteries have been wanting to honor you in your retirement. So it's my pleasure to present to you a check for $35,000 that the two of you can use as you see fit, travel, do whatever you will with it. But it's just a token of the appreciation. And there may be more coming in, but that's what's here. But that's what's here tonight. And that's all. But anyway, thank you.
Thank you, John. Anyway.
God bless both of you. Thank you.
You want five more?
Or no, I get five? No, I'm giving you five.
Okay. I'll take five.
Well, I don't want to be blamed for being late.
Okay. We're good. Well, thank you. Thank you all very much. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Ephesians 2:10 has been very much on my mind this week. I'm so grateful to God for electing me, for forgiving me, for saving me, for equipping me, for calling me to this ministry in 2006. It has been a labor of love. It hasn't always been easy, but the way the Lord put this call on my heart, it was a labor of love. I'm so grateful that I was given the freedom to be who I was in this position, a pastor. So grateful for that. Second, I'm going to skip ahead. Andrew, I hope you take this the right way, all right? It didn't matter whether I knew you or not. You're one of ours. You're one of our guys. It didn't matter. And you were in trouble, and we were going to do everything we could to get you home. I think it was Bill that said, Jeff, you led us in prayer. But I have to tell you that in late August of 2018, I think it was right after one of those trials where there was high hopes that were dashed, I found I couldn't pray anymore. And I was in a pit. I was in a pit of despair. And who was it that pulled me out of that pit? But it was my precious wife, Cindy, who said to me, Jeff, now we know why, instead of spending 1 year at Fourth Church in Washington, D.C., we were there for 14. And you became familiar with, and you became comfortable with Capitol Hill and the federal government and the White House. Jeff, God has called you for such a time as this. And that pulled me out of the pit. So, if the greatest gift I have ever received is God's gift of salvation to me in Jesus Christ, the second greatest gift that he gave me is my precious Cindy, my number one supporter and encourager and counsel. Through it all, she's been my rock, or as George would put it, my North Star. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. I love you. I love you. And to all of you, thank you for your love and prayers for us these past few years. Cindy is doing great. And as you can see, she wonderfully expresses the joy and the beauty of Jesus Christ. I will finish with the words. You want to take a picture, Case? He is risen.
It is only appropriate that we conclude tonight in prayer, and it's only appropriate that the colleague that Jeff chose and called to serve alongside of him and who has been a marvelous team together, that Jerry Iamuri would close us this evening. Thank you all for being here. Don't forget your flowers to take them with you, and thank you, Jerry.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the ministry of Jeff Jeremiah. And Lord, we thank you so much for his magnificent wife, Cindy. How much she has meant to us, words cannot easily express. The love that she has shown our spouses and us as we labored alongside Jeff is unparalleled. And Lord, I just want to thank you for Jeff and the way that he has provided for, protected, and promoted the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.